सुषमा वी कैन स्टार्ट नाउ वी आर लाइव ऑन फेसबुक
ओके वेलकम एवरीवन एंड थैंक यू फॉर जॉइनिंग इन दिस सेशन एस्पेशली ऑन दिस संडे मॉर्निंग आई एम सुषमा पाटिल सीनियर जेनेटिक काउंसलर फ्रॉम न्यूबर्ग सेंटर फॉर जीनोमिक मेडिसिन टुडे वी हैव द ऑनर ऑफ टॉकिंग टू डॉक्टर अरुण वारियर हु इज अ कंसल्टेंट मेडिकल ऑन्कोलॉजी नाउ एस्टर मेडिसिटी. He has more than 10 years of experience and specializes in comprehensive management of solid tumors and lymphomas in adults. He's been trained at some of the finest institutes in India as well as UK, and he's an expert in providing multidisciplinary cancer care. The best part is that he combines different treatment modes, including genomic risk stratification, molecular targeted therapy and immunotherapy based on international protocols. His special interests lies in gastrointestinal oncology and immunotherapy treatment in cancer. We all have been hearing a lot about immunotherapy, and I feel that Dr. Arun is the best person to tell us about what are the advances that are happening in breast cancer treatment. So I would like to start this session. Dr. Arun, one main question I had. Yes.
Okay.
So I think what I would like to understand is first the basics and then getting into the treatment aspect of it. So,
understood. Yeah. Okay.
First is I would like to understand, I've heard that there are a lot of types of cancer, breast cancers. So if you could tell us what are the types of cancers.
Yeah, so generally, if you see breast cancers, the majority are called as invasive ductal carcinoma. So that comprises a 90% of all breast cancers. Then there are some other unclassified cancers. But I think for the layman, we have to say whether it's an invasive cancer or it's an in situ cancer. So that is the main thing, because with mammography and screening, we are finding more and more of ductal carcinoma in situs, which we can't really tell they are cancers because they are not invaded into the body. But the treatment is entirely different. So chemotherapy and all may not come there. So I think that is the main thing which people have to understand, whether it is an invasive cancer or an in situ cancer. I think
So invasive would mean it can spread to the other parts.
Correct.
Is it?
Correct. So the treatment has to be more aggressive for invasive cancers, where we may have to, they may require some sort of chemotherapy and all, depending on the stratification and all. And surgical aspects also change, because in an invasive cancers, we have to sample the lymph nodes and all has to be sampled. But it's an in situ cancer, only that part has to be removed, and the rest of the breast we can treat with maybe patient can be given to the rest of the breast. So the treatment, the surgical aspects also change on this aspect. And nowadays, we are seeing more and more of in situ cancers because people go for mammography screening and all. And many cancers which are diagnosed like this are in situ cancers. So that has been one of the reasons. In the West, we have seen a pandemic surge of breast cancers happened when the mammography they started doing for all people, the screening started and all. The majority were comprising of these in situ cancers.
Okay. So when we say that the incidence of breast cancer is increasing, one of the important aspect might be because more people are undergoing screening.
Correct. Yeah, because we are able to pick up more and more small lesions. So that is one of the thing. And incidence definitely, some other factors are there, like the changes in the lifestyle which has happened, the aging population, because majority of breast cancers come in people in the after the menopause. So maybe in the 60 plus, and people are living for a longer period. The average lifespan in India is around 70 plus now, which was when we got independence, it was only 37, 38 years. So it has almost doubled in maybe 50, 60 years in one generation time. So it has definitely led to an upsurge in the incidence of cancers. And again, people are more health awareness now, and infections, cardio problems, all people are able to tide over. And we commonly see people who have underwent bypass, angioplasty in the 70s, and then they're diagnosed with cancer. So aging and the lifestyle also has a role in the increasing incidence of of breast cancer and any other cancers.
Okay. So when a person comes to you with a lung or suspicion of cancer, how do you diagnose cancer?
Yeah. So whenever a patient comes, then we have to see the age, because the lumps can be, again, because it's a general awareness talk, I'm just focusing on the other lumps also which can come. So any age you can have lumps in the breast, because for females, breast is a hormonally sensitive organ. Based on the various phases of the menstrual cycle, because of the effects of the hormones, small lumps can form in the breast and then they may go away. We call it like a fibrocystic disease, which is a very common scenario in the young population. So we are not bothered about that much. We tell them to observe that, and people are almost 30-40% of females may have some sort of pain in their breast, and it's not that we should jump and do scans for all these people. So we have to advise them, properly counsel them, that we have to observe that, and if anything new comes up, then definitely it requires more of scans. And again, if they're young, like in their 30s and maybe up to 40-45, the consistency of the breast is such that even if you do a mammogram, it may not pick up. So we have to do ultrasounds, and sometimes we may do an MRI of the breast also to see what is the exact nature of the lesion. But if they are in their 40s and 50s, then mammography is good enough. So I think that should be the initial test, because just by examination, we may not be able to tell whether it is a cancer or not, because we see more and more of people coming with small lumps. Like in a private hospital where I'm working, almost 70% of the breast cancers are diagnosed when they're just 2 centimeters. That is when they're just felt, they come. While in the West, it is almost up to 80-90%, because people come fast. So this is not the case in the rural India, or people who are not aware of it, where still we see a lot of advanced cancers coming up. So I think with people becoming more aware, we should be cautious about these small lumps. And after a proper clinical examination, we have to do a mammography for them. And based on the mammography, they will grade it. A grade from 1 to 5 will be there. And if the grade is 4 and above, we may have to do a biopsy on that. So I think that is the first step for evaluation: do an examination, do an imaging, and then proceed with a biopsy.
Okay. So what are the treatment options that are available? I've heard because chemotherapy is there, surgical procedures are there, radiation is there. So how do you decide which patient goes
to? So again, before going to the treatment per se, I think once we do a biopsy, then we have to send it for pathology. Because the pathologists are the people. You are all pathologists, I think. You are a lab purple. So the pathologists are the people who look it and who see the slides under the microscope, and then they will be able to tell whether they are cancerous or not. And if they're cancers, like invasive cancers, we definitely do more tests for them. We do imaging to know whether it has spread to other parts of the body. We do scans. Sometimes we may do PET scans also. And after that, there's a multidisciplinary team is there, where the where the doctor, the surgeon, the medical, the radiation oncologist, pathologist, and the radiologist all sit together, and then they discuss about what is the best for the patient. And if they have small lumps, then definitely the first option will be whether the whole breast has to be removed or not, or we can conserve the breast. I think that is one of the major problems, isn't it? For because I just want some indexes, so that's what I'm just asking you, because I think that's one of the major worries of the patient,
yes,
isn't it? Whether
yes.
the breast has to be removed or not.
Yeah.
So many people ask us this question. So again, it is based on whether it is a small lump or not, and or how much area of the breast is involved or not. So nowadays, surgeons are very comfortable by doing a breast conservation surgery in whichever setting it is possible. So again, people ask us whether it is safe to remove the whole breast or not like that. Even if a part is removed, then we can give radiation to the remaining breast. So the studies have shown for the last 20 to 30 years, this technique has been in use. And if we give radiation to other parts of the breast, the chance that it may come back is very low. So we can safely conserve the breast in very small lesions. And again, depending on if it is in the central part, there are multiple lumps, it may not be possible. So that's why surgeon has to see and decide based on the imaging also. So I think breast conservation will be the first thing for an early breast cancer. If it is spread to other areas, surgery, we won't do surgery. Then I think some questions are coming up. So maybe you can look into those questions and ask me those, because otherwise I will get lost in between. So you can have a check on the questions. Okay, fine. Yeah. And I think once the surgery is done, then we see whether we will be sampling the nodes, because cancer also follows a pattern. it starts from the breast, then it can go to the axilla, from there it can go to the neck, or it can go to other parts of the body also. So if they are, then we will sample the nodes in the axilla, and if they spread to the axilla, then definitely we have to give them chemotherapy, because there's a chance it can come to other parts of the body also, so they will be given chemo. Radiation is again depending on if the conservation is done, then the remaining breast has to be radiated, or if there is more nodes involved in the axilla, then also radiation has to be given. So I think those are the main questions about how to decide when surgery and radiation. I will come to chemos later.
Okay. So yeah. What I get from this is that we can decide on breast conservation based on number of what is the lump size.
Yes, correct.
And based on that, radiation is required or not for the recurrence to not happen. Radiation is one of the options, which is
one of the options. Correct. In the breast, if it is conserved, and also in the axilla, that is armpit, because from the breast it can go to the armpit. So that's why these two areas radiation may be given for that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So one of the questions which we have is, as per your clinical experience, what is the incidence of hereditary breast cancer?
Hereditary, because any cancer, that is the common question which people ask, whether it runs in family or not, because this taboo is there, that if somebody has got a cancer, the whole family at risk, or people come and tell, none in our family had cancer, then why I got that? So this, but cancer is not a hereditary disease. Only rarely it is like that. It's not that it's there for all. And if one person is affected, it is not mandatory that their siblings or their children are at increased risk. Okay, the hereditary breast cancers, around 5 to 10% are hereditary breast cancer, which means there is a damage in the DNA. Commonly we call it as BRCA, that is a breast-related cancer antigen. I think after Angelina Jolie had this BRCA gene, so it became I think many people are aware of that. So that means there is a damage in the BRCA gene, and if somebody has got that damage in their body, then their body is not able to repair the cells. So that puts them at increased risk. So this BRCA gene mutation may be the reason for 5 to 10% for all breast cancers. But then again, it is not that everybody has to be screened for that. Because when we see a patient, we take the family history, whether there are multiple members in the family are involved or not, whether if a patient's sisters are involved, had cancer, if their brother had cancer, if their parents had cancer, then we may do this BRCA gene test. Now, this BRCA gene, again, the testing is, it's only simple blood test, and the people and the blood has to be, maybe cost around 20,000 rupees for the test to be done. And this blood will be analyzed, and it's a damage in the DNA. Then the same areas will be checked for the kits also. So it's not that we offer it for all patients. There are some specific types, like triple negative cancers, young, less than 40-year-old breast cancers, somebody with a breast and ovarian cancer, and like I told, multiple family members, only for them we do this. Because if we do for all, then we may pick up some small things here which we don't know what is the reason. So it may cause unnecessary alarm for the people. Okay, yes. So that is why we do for specific subsets. Okay.
Yes. As doctor has said, I would like to emphasize that yes, only 5 to 10% breast cancers are actually hereditary. And I have myself been a genetic counselor, and doctors, you can openly discuss this with your doctors to understand whether your case is hereditary or not. There are multiple parameters which are taken into consideration before suggesting whether it is hereditary or not. Sir, I wanted to understand, BRCA testing is also used for treatment purpose now, right? So what is it?
Yeah.
What kind of changes are made in the treatment if it is BRCA positive?
Yeah, because BRCA positivity has a major impact on not in early breast cancers, but in cancers which have spread to other parts. Particularly for breast cancers, if they are BRCA positive, we may offer them some drugs called as PARP inhibitors, which have shown to improve their survival. And again, in ovarian cancer, because that is again a common female cancer. So in ovarian cancer also, we do BRCA testing, and again, we can do this specific PARP inhibitors, which has shown to prolong the survival. So they're important in treatment, may not be an early case, but if the disease is spread to them, it is very relevant to do a BRCA test.
Okay. Next question we have is from Rashmi. What type of diet will you suggest to a breast cancer patient? Does diet play a major role?
Yeah. So that also includes in the what we call as the changes in the lifestyle. So what it has shown that a diet rich in fatty food changes, generally we all know that it makes us unhealthy. So what we tell is that we have to maintain a healthy body weight, and in that a healthy diet also comes in. So it is not that somebody should take this or should not take that. So we have to balance, because the changes, if you say in India itself is such a huge country, the diet which they take in Kashmir is not what we take in Kerala. So we cannot tell what is the ideal diet for a person. What they have been used from the childhood, and all of us know, if you take a lot of paneer, it is as bad as taking a lot of non-veg. So it is not that we should not take non-veg, not like that, but fried diet should be reduced, red meat has to be reduced, and that will all have an implication on the general health status, and that will also help reduce incidence of breast cancer also. But I am not for this health fads like people promote, like when you if you take some special diet, there are some exotic fruits are there which people promote, and they are not been shown to cause to reduce the incidence of breast cancer. It is just what we get, all of us get some of the messages promoting that you take this diet, you take this food. There is no scientific proof for that, because again, cancer is a very complex disease, and diet is just one of the things in that. And what is more worrying is that sometimes people tend to take all these herbal things and all, and even if they have a lump in the breast, they keep on taking these fruits and what all exotic things, and they don't go for tests. So that is again a worrying thing. So if you have a suspicion, you should not think that taking this special diet is going to reduce that. So if you have a suspicious lump or any other symptoms of cancer like bleeding, weight loss, fever, it can be anything. And if there is something abnormal in your body, don't go for diet immediately. You should go for checkup. But if you're taking a healthy diet as part of healthy lifestyle, well and good. No one is going to prevent you from that. But don't go for exotic fruits and all those things. They just have maintain a healthy weight. So that's again what we do. There's a healthy adult weight for all of us. Somebody may weigh 80 kg. Somebody may weigh 50 kg. So 80 may be normal for a person. So just try to maintain that. Fluctuations are always bad. Somebody may go for a sudden crash diet and exercise and all, and weight will come. Then they may again go for binge eating. So this is to be avoided, because body won't be able to modify according to this fluctuation. So that healthy weight has to be maintained. So that is the main thing. Same applies to the diet also. Whatever you are used from the childhood, you try to maintain that in the diet also. The one more question was about the breast cancer patients per se. So they're definitely, if they're diagnosed with breast cancer, then we may give them chemotherapy, which will suppress their immunity. So in that scenario, they have to be more careful. Whatever food they eat has to be cooked food, and they should try to prevent this fried diet and oily diet and all, because it can cause vomiting and all. So my bland diet, which is more of proteins, will be better.
I think, thank you, Dr. Arun, for bringing up this point that few people don't come immediately to the doctor, even if they feel a lump, thinking that it will dissolve on their own, or I am doing everything right, so it's not possible that this lump will turn out to be cancer.
So, yeah, so that's very important. Very common thing for them, because breast cancer is one of the cancers which can be easily diagnosed. It is there on your body, so any lady will be able to feel a lump. So that is why once it is around 2 centimeters, that they will feel. But then when we ask, they will give very unusual answers. I was waiting for my son's exam to be over, for my daughter's pregnancy to be over. So all these reasons will come up. So we should not do that, because within a few months' time, it's very commonly a small lump would have grown. And a stage 1 cancer would have become stage 4. So cancer doesn't wait for all these things. So in a few months, it can progress, and that and a patient with a minimal treatment was required would have become incurable. So there is no time when we have the suspicion. So you should immediately act. That is very important.
Is it true that early diagnosis would be better survival?
Yeah, correct. Because it makes our the treatment easier. Because for a stage 1 cancer, it may be simple hormonal blockade, that's all. But if it is stage 3 cancer, then mandatorily chemotherapy and radiation has to be given. And the stage 1 to 3 or 4 changes happen over a few months. Because when we speak to patients, they tell, I felt this lump 2 months, maybe 6 months back. Then this COVID had a big impact. Because many patients, when we see now, they're telling, because of COVID, they were afraid to go to hospitals. They waited. And they they only tell in a few, and when we do the scans, it would have already spread. So that's, it's quite unfortunate. So that is again that fear of COVID should not prevent them from doing checkups, because if there is any suspicious thing, that they should definitely take medical help. And I think the chance of getting COVID from a hospital, that also people have told, is just 1 in 100. And the chance of getting it if you go to a supermarket or all, it may be almost same or more than that. So you should not prevent, because most of the all of the hospitals follow standard precautions are there. And if you follow the standard precaution, you should do the social distancing, wear masks, and all those things. And the chances are very less. And we are also trying to prevent rush in most of the hospitals now. So only required patients are nowadays coming to us. That's also a good thing. So do at least a telemedicine consultations, take an appointment, do scans. So if there is a suspicion, don't wait for the COVID to be over, because we know it's going to take a long time, and cancer is not going to wait for that. And already we are seeing patients progressing in the last few months. So whoever has got a suspicious lump, they should do. That's one of the things which we are trying to get. Yeah.
So whoever has a suspicion, do visit a doctor. Next question that we have is, what are the main causes of breast cancer?
Yeah, causes. See, that is a very, very broad question, because no one really knows what is the one cause of cancer. It's a multiple factors are all contributing. That's why lifestyle, diet, aging all contribute. Okay, hereditary all may play a role. So what we'd advise is that if you do a proper lifestyle, if you don't take addiction, don't have any habits and all, then almost 30-40% risk is low. But still, almost 50% get cancer even with all this. Like you told before, somebody may feel, I am doing everything. Like people commonly tell us, I have been exercising, I have been fall. Then why this happened to me? And then the answer is that it is just a random thing. It doesn't prevent you from getting cancer. It is just a, what is happening in cancer is that there's a damage in the DNA, and this damage can happen because of many reasons, isn't it? So we can't really prevent that. Then finally, what the scientists are telling is that after all this, even if you do routine things, then cancer is an accident. So it can happen to anyone. So there's no point in going behind the reason for getting cancer. That's what science is telling us now. So don't think that you won't get cancer if you follow everything also. That risk is always there. And you try to follow a healthy lifestyle and try to avoid addictions and all, then you are safe. And again, we tell people that because you are doing all this and you have been healthy, you will be able to take treatment also in a better way. So that is also very important. If you're healthy, the treatment also will be easier. Surgery, chemo, whatever, will be easier for the patient.
There's one more question. Habit of using very tight clothes around your chest, does it cause cancer?
Should not, because whatever trials have shown that it's not the physical thing. It's not the physical damage to the breast which is the cause of cancer. It is the DNA damage which occurs in the cells. And whatever the tight clothes should not cause any damage to the DNA. So I don't think that is that should be a reason for cancer. And again, the same thing, mobile phone, hair dye, all comes here. And the answer which you tell is that all of them won't damage the DNA. The people who know physics know that the rays which are used in microwave and mobile phones don't damage the DNA. So because they don't damage the DNA, they should not cause cancer.
I think we had so many WhatsApps talking about all this. So it's important that we tell them that it's actually a myth and not a reality that all this causes cancer.
Correct.
One very important question we have got is, how do we avoid recurrence?
Yeah. So before recurrence, I think we should go a little more about the treatment aspect, because I just stopped with our surgery and radiation. Radiation. So the main worry for people is chemotherapy, isn't it? Because surgery will be over in a week's time, the wound will heal. So radiation is only given to the breast. That also won't cause much of a problem. So chemo is the one which people are worried. And if you ask people,
Krishna, are you able to hear me?
We are not able to hear you, Sushma.
Okay.
Sushma, we have lost Dr. Arun Warrior.
Yeah.
You can't hear.
Dr. Arun?
I'll ping him WhatsApp.
Okay.
Oh, he's back.
In between, I got disconnected, isn't it? I'm back now? Yeah, fine. So I think we were talking about chemotherapy, isn't it? Yeah. So, chemotherapy, the main advantage is that it prevents the cancer from coming back in other parts, like in the lung, liver, bones, and all. Because prior to the era of chemotherapy, people used to get recurrent more. Because the small microscopic cells will be remaining in other parts, which again grows later. But if you give chemo, these microscopic cells will also go away. So that is the basic dictum of chemo. But when we give chemo, it has an effect on the fast-growing cells. That is why they lose the hair. And for an early breast cancer, whatever chemo which we give now, we all follow some scientific protocols. And according to the guidelines, we have to give them chemo. It is not that I select chemo or XYZ doctor selects the chemo. We all have some scientific protocols. And whichever chemo is now currently recommended for the curative intent for breast cancer, they will all lead to loss of hair. But again, it comes back. The benefit of chemo is so high that we have to convince the patients that, and we have to tailor the treatment that they take chemo to be sure that it doesn't come back. So that is chemo. And again, there are some drugs which block the hormone receptors, which will be there for almost 75% of breast cancers. So because they block the hormone receptors, again, when we do the biopsy, we do the checking. We check the hormone ER receptors, we check the HER2 receptors and all, and we block these receptors. That also prevents the cancer from coming back. So almost 75% of breast cancer will be hormone receptor positive. And some people, like in a postmenopausal elderly patients and all, we may not give them chemo. We may just give them this hormonal blockade. And there are newer HER2 therapies like anti for 25% of cancers, which are again, we give them these drugs to prevent the recurrences. So these are all steps, like chemotherapy is one step, hormone blockade is one step, HER2 is one step. And nowadays newer drugs are coming up, like BRCA, PARP inhibitors are coming up. There are various other drugs. I'm not going to the details of that because it's a big scenario. And that is, again, one more thing, which breast cancer is such a big disease. It is not like getting malaria or not like getting like that. Because there are a lot of things we have to see. Because pathology or the molecular diagnosis has grown so much that we have to, that a molecular risk stratification is there, and we can do some special tests which may tell us that the patient, there is no need for further chemo for them. Only problem is that these tests are a bit expensive, but in Indian tests are also coming up now. So in future, maybe we can avoid chemo for almost 30% of our patients whom we are giving now. Only thing, we have to do this molecular predictive test has to be done for our patients. So it's a very wide scenario. Okay.
So one of the things that people are afraid of is that cancer treatment, matlab I'll lose my hair. But
yeah,
as you rightly said, that chemotherapy is important so that the recurrence rate is reduced.
Correct.
So there's always a risk versus benefit ratio. And here the benefit is much more. Hair will come back after some time, but by giving chemotherapy, the recurrence rate reduces, and in turn also survival rate, and they can have a healthy life after that.
Correct. And again, people are there are some chemos which people won't lose their hair, but it is not for breast cancer. Like chemos which we give for colon cancer, that colon in the intestines and all, that chemo they won't have hair loss. Maybe in the future we may get some chemo regimens which won't have this side effect. So okay. We should wait for that. Yeah.
Another thing is important question is one person is BRCA positive. In those cases, what a person should do?
Yeah, if there is a BRCA positivity is there, then we have to see what type of mutation it is. If it is really known to have cause cancer, I think you will be able to tell more about that. So what is your opinion? You can just briefly educate the public about the BRCA scenario.
Okay, yeah. So as we had initially said that just 5-10% cases are hereditary in nature, what happens in those cases is a person is born with a genetic change because of which the gene is not working well. This BRCA gene is actually important to prevent cancer. So if there is a change, that means there is an increased risk. But one important aspect of BRCA, being BRCA positive, is it doesn't mean that you are going to get 100% get cancer in future. what it means is compared to other people, there is an increased risk of getting cancer, breast cancer and ovarian cancer. So in those cases, for breast cancer, as it is, if a person has got already breast cancer, then there is a risk for the other breast also having cancer. But then in those cases, the imaging techniques will be different and there will be increased surveillance in those cases so that we'll be able to pick it up at an early stage. Also, there is an option of removal of breast before it happens so that the risk is reduced. So for breast cancer, there are these options available. For ovarian cancer, again, as they can undergo rigorous surveillance, but what is recommended is they, after family is completed, they can undergo removal of ovaries as well.
So why I asked you is that because the genetic counsel is very important for us, because this BRCA test ideally has to be done only after genetic counseling. Yeah. Because many hospitals don't have us, but what we do is that we do a phone consultation, because these reports can be very dicey. Sometimes something like a variant of unknown significance will come, where we really don't know whether it is significant or not. And all these patients has to be followed up. So that is why we tell people don't do this test unnecessarily, because sometimes if you get this unknown significance, you will be tense for throughout your life, because it may not be of any problem, but this stress will always be there. So that's why we have to really pick the persons whom we should do this test.
So what Dr. Arun is talking about is something which we call as pre-test genetic counseling session. In that, we tell you everything about this hereditary cancer. First is based on your personal and family history. We do risk stratification, and then tell you whether actually you fit in something called as, according to guidelines, if there is an increased risk for it or not, and how much of a benefit actually testing will have. And after that, what do each report mean, and what can be done to, if it is positive, then what are the next steps that a person can take? So it's very important that you make an informed decision after having this discussion. Every person is different and every person responds to situations differently. You are the best person to understand how much of information actually do you want to know.
I think one good question was that the incidence of breast cancer is much lower than the US. So that's a correct statement, because they do mammography for all. A mammography has to be done after the age of 50. 40 to 50 is still not sure, but from 50 to 70 years of age, once in 2 years, mammography has to be done. And if you do it so rigorously, then like ductal carcinoma institutes may be picked up. That is one reason why the incidence is higher. But in India, screening has not been that common, but we are seeing more and more of cancers. And other thing is that how often we see women under the age of 45 years. That is again, because what they tell is that in India, the incidence is almost a decade earlier than in the West. For some reason, if you ask me, it's quite common. People in their 30s, 40s coming with breast cancer. But sadly, we don't have any screening for them. It is usually picked up by the patient, and then they do scans, MR, and then we do that. And the youngest patients whom I have treated is a 21-year-old. Although historically, up to 11 years, it has been reported. 20s is now definitely more. And when you analyze our tumor risk, almost 10% is in the second 20 to 30-year-old age group, and 30 to 40 is also on the higher thing. And another question was about side effects of chemotherapy. Because I am a medical oncologist, I deal with the chemos mainly. The side effects are basically the hair loss, which I told. You have to wear a wig or something. There is no other option for that. We can't prevent that if it is curative. Second is they have low counts, in which we give them boosters. There is something called as colony stimulating factors. And if you give these boosters, then the chance of low counts and infection can be reduced. Third is main issue is about vomiting. Vomiting, again, there are good anti-vomiting drugs are there. And if we give them, hardly anyone is admitted with vomiting nowadays. So vomiting, we can give tablets to prevent low counts. We can give boosters. And generally what happens during chemo is that these chemos are given once in 2 to 3 weeks. So they come in the OP, they take the chemo and go back home. And for the 1 or 2 days, they may be a bit tired, but majority of them go back to work, because in private, I'm sure that if they're working, no one gives them leave for 6 months. So they all go back to their work after after 1 or 2 days leave, they can go back to their work. And what we want them is that if you are feeling down, then immediately consult a doctor. If you are getting fever, that is again to be, you have to again bring that to our attention. So if that is not there, then majority of them can go back to their routine. Definitely they can do their household jobs and all these things. It is not that the chemotherapy for breast cancer doesn't make you lie down for 6 months. That is again some misconception which people get. That happens for very intensive treatments like leukemias and all. It's not there for breast cancer because it's a preventive type of chemo, so they can go on with their routines. So that is one more thing of side effects of chemo. And I think other question was about what is the recommended screening for somebody with a hormone replacement therapy. See, this hormone replacement therapy is nowadays very controversial because people do in postmenopausal, and definitely we know that almost 80% of breast cancer are dependent on the hormone, like estrogen. So definitely the risk is on the higher side. So screening, and if possible nowadays, the tablets are actually, people don't avoid giving them tablets. We ask them to do local treatments for hormone replacements nowadays, and they have to be more aware of this. And again, infertility treatment, because again, that is one area where people give hormonal manipulation. But again, as you told, like somebody wants to, they are also counseled about the increased risk, but definitely somebody wants to have a kid, they take this risk, and they are also more aware of this. And what we tell is anything suspicious, immediately come to our attention. And again, pregnancy and breastfeeding is area where these lumps can be initially they may be neglected. So that again, they may think because of lactation or breastfeeding is coming. So seeing any new questions come, 3 questions, yes, which are there in my chat box. Yeah.
So one thing is, what is hormone replacement therapy, which they're talking about?
Yeah, generally, I think hormone replacement is for postmenopausal setting, like after the periods given hormonal tablets, like either estrogen, progesterone are given. So these tablets can have an effect on, they can increase the growth of the, increase the chance of breast cancer also, because they have an effect on the breast cells. So that is why we have to be more cautious, because they may stimulate the breast cells to grow, and this stimulation can transform to cancer. Okay, so that is about, in brief, about hormone replacement and how it increases the risk of breast cancer.
There's one more question. Is it possible that mammogram 6 months ago, it was BRAC 0 to 1, and now when it is repeated, shows BRAC 3 to 4 and malignancy?
Yeah, it's possible, because this mammogram only tells us that at that point, there is no cancer. It's not that after 2 months, suddenly cancer can come. So you should not be, thinking that I got a mammogram and I got a new lump. So anything new coming in between, yeah, we have to again consult. And again, this BRAC scoring is again based on the lump they were able to tell. BRAC 1, 2, 3 can be observed. 4 and above has to be biopsied. So this change can happen. And that's why mammogram has to be repeated also. Maybe once in every 2 years, mammogram has to be repeated.
Yes. Next question is, is mammography recommended above 40 years, and how do we detect cancer in early younger women?
Yeah, younger women, as I told, I think I just mentioned that, because in the younger, less than the age of 40, it is very difficult to pick up cancers on a mammogram, because mammogram is an X-ray of the breast, and because of the consistency is different in the younger age group, it may not pick up. After the 40 to 50, it is still a debate. For some, it may be hello, some it may not be. The recommendation is after the age of 50, definitely yes. So younger age group, why we don't tell them to do screening is incidence or the chance that a young patient can get breast cancer is very low. So that is why we don't advise them to do a breast cancer screening. But any lump, definitely age doesn't matter. Anything new coming up, anything coming, they have to attend. And one other thing is that the pain. People tell that there is no pain, that's why it didn't come. It is not like that. It's not that cancerous lumps should have pain. Pain happens only when the lump is huge, like it is touching on the nerves, muscles, and all. Maybe up to 3 to 4 centimeter size, breast cancers won't have any pain. So that is one more thing which people have to be cautious. It is you should not relax that there is no pain. It is not cancer. Okay, because the pain, because breast is basically fatty tissue, so it's a collection of cells inside the fat. So it may not have pain in the initial times. Okay, so you should not be relaxed that pain.
How often should one person have mammography after the age of 50?
Once in every 2 years. Once in every 2 years. Every yearly, societies tell, but I don't think it's practically feasible. So practically, we tell them to get it done once every 2 years up to the age of 70.
Another important question is it okay to get PET CT done every year?
No. You should not go. You see, normal patients should not do PET scans because they have a radionucleated isotopy there, and no one really knows. And if diagnosed with breast cancer, then also for to find out whether it is coming back or not, there are some routine tests up there like mammogram, ultrasound, and X-ray, which will screen whether it is coming in the other breast, whether it is coming in the liver or lung. So PET CT again should be done only if there is a suspicion of cancer in the routine test, because it may not be safe to do it, because breast cancer patients may be cured, they may live on for 20 to 30 years, and exposing them to PET scan every year, it can have a negative impact also. So this breast cancer survivors, we advise them not to do PET scans, do safe tests like an ultrasound, X-ray, and all, and only if there is suspicion in these tests, then only go for a PET CT.
So it would be good to ask the doctor first rather than going.
Yes, you should not do. I think it is mandated. I think most of the labs don't advise without a doctor's prescription. They don't do that. But still, it is very tough to convince patients because they feel doing a PET scan shows that they are okay. But again, the problem is that even if you do a PET scan, the cancer can come back within 1 or 2 months. That also we have seen. Somebody had a very much normal scan in July, can come back with the cancer in September. So it doesn't give you any guarantee, or it doesn't assure you that you won't get cancer for the next 1 year. So it's only false assurance. Okay, so that's why we should not do PET scans frequently. But again, during treatment, we may do. Somebody has got a metastatic cancer to see what is the response to treatment. We may do it once in every 6 months because that helps us in tailoring the management for the patient. And definitely before starting on the treatment for a staging also, we may do a PET scan because it gives a comprehensive idea of which all areas are involved or not. So definitely it has a role in staging, but it's not mandatory. It's not that it should be done for all patients with breast cancer, because even now recommendations are there to do only CT scans and a bone scan. But if in a hospital PET scan is available, there is no harm in doing that. It's not mandatory that all breast cancer patients should get a PET scan done before starting on treatment.
What I understand is over these many years, there has been a lot of advances in the chemotherapy or treatment aspect. So could you talk a little more about what I know is key now, because more treatments are available, the survival is more. Initially, it used to be like breast cancer hai, so might mean not the patient not living anymore.
Survival.
But it has changed a lot.
Not like that. Correct. Definitely. Yes. Because in early breast cancer, the survival is more than 80-90%. Early means centimeter lumps, which are not spread to the armpit and all. Small lumps and all, 80-90% people survive. And if it is a little more advanced, like locally advanced breast cancer, survival comes down to 50-60%. And in breast cancer, even if it is stage 4, like even if it has spread to other parts of the body, almost 30% live for 5 years, which is a good number, because breast cancer is one which responds well to treatment. So that is why even in stage 4, we tell, because stage 4 means immediately everyone will think they are going to die soon. Not like that. Because a lot of treatment options are there, like chemotherapy regimens are there, which are well tolerated. And we have seen people taking chemo, one course may be over. Then after 1 year, we may again subject them to chemotherapy. Like that, multiple times chemotherapy may be given for the patient. It's not that once chemo is given, we cannot do it again. Not like that. So we have seen patients getting chemo maybe 3-4 times, and I think largest which I have seen is up to 7 times, that is in blocks. So people can get blocks of chemo, and there are oral chemo drugs are there which are all well tolerated. And as I told before, this hormone blockade, HER2 blockade, PARP inhibitors, there are a lot of, like palbociclib, ribociclib. There's a lot of drugs are there with us now, and we have tailored it. So that is the main thing. It's a personalized treatment for the patient, in which a lot of pathological risk factors, genomic risk factors are profiling has to be done, and we have to discuss with the patient, because some of the treatment may be quite expensive also. So we have to have a frank discussion about what we are expecting from this, and whether it is whether we afford this or not. And all this has to be discussed, and then only we will be able to come to a treatment plan. Okay.
You've already spoken a lot about this, but I still would want to ask. One of the things which patients say is I got only 4 cycles of chemotherapy. The next person says has 6 or 12 chemotherapy cycles. Why is it different for her?
Yeah, because again, it depends on the staging of the cancer. And for early stage, we may just give 4. And nowadays, the protocol for breast cancer is for 8 cycles of chemo, 4 cycles of anthracyclines, and 4 cycles of taxanes. That's how we tell them. So that's how now the recommendations are. Previously, it used to be 6. And in very early stage, which we tell the risk is very low, if they're elderly, 70-year-old and all, then we may just go for 4 cycles. So it is, again, based on the patient's health, stage of the disease and all. Okay.
One question is, how is PET CT different from MRI? When are these tests recommended?
This MRI of the breast we do before breast conservation. We have to know more details about the architecture of the breast. Then we may do an MRI of the breast. Again, for screening, like in positive and all, breast MRI may be required because radiation is not there with an MRI scan. So that's when we do that. In follow-up, rarely, if there sometimes people are use the processes of the breast implants may be there, because in that cases we cannot do an mammography, then we may go for an MRI. This PET CT is to know what is the activity of the disease, because when we do a breast, the cancer will light up. So if the cancer, then we will be able to know what is the exact staging. So it's an entirely different thing. Breast MRI is for local staging of the breast, how aggressive it is. But while PET CT is for a whole body to know which are the areas to which the cancer spread or not. So these tests are recommended. Breast MRI, there are a few indicators for an MRI. PET CT for staging. And again, if you're suspecting a relapse, we may do a PET CT.
Tamoxifen is given for few patients. So when is it given? Why is it given?
Yeah, tamoxifen is for hormone receptor blockade. There are two class of drugs are there. One is tamoxifen, and others is aromatase inhibitors like letrozole, anastrozole. So what they all do is that they block the hormone sensitive cells. So 75% of breast cancers will have either a hormone receptor, or progesterone receptors will be there. So if we block them, then again the chance of recurrence will be less for them. So that is where we give these drugs for them. Okay. And we may continue them for a period of 5 to 10 years of time. Tamoxifen can be continued even up to 10 years to prevent recurrences, while letrozole may be given only up to a period of 5 years. That again is based on the patient's age and other factors. Suppose Leslie.
One of the things which was brought up is, I guess you also have a support group for breast cancer.
Yeah.
How important is to have that support?
It's very important, because whatever the doctors tell, the patient's perspective may be entirely different. So we all have a counselors in most of the hospitals who will be able to speak to the patients. So they again discuss in detail about the various emotional aspects, how to cope with the disease and all. So this counselors help for that. And in some cases, people will be very much depressed. They will be crying. And the main thing is that they won't be willing also. So in that case, we may have to give them some medications, because unless the mind is prepared, the body won't be able to take responded. The treatment. So the responded. So the side effects will be more for them. And I think if it is a curative thing, in almost 90-95% of the cases, we will be able to tell them. And once the patient understands that it's a curative thing, they'll be willing for that. The cancer, that is the one thing we have to remove. And once that is gone, then most of the willing for treatment. But there are very resistant cases whom we had to give them, even antidepressants has to be continued for them. But support groups, a good thing is that the more than the medical and the social workers counseling. Once a patient tells, then from the patient perspective, they will be able to counsel, because how to face this, how to the society, how they look at, and how to maintain the side effect, how to manage the toxicity treatment. So we have some people who have a very positive approach to cancer. So I think most of the hospitals have at least 5 to 10 such active patients who voluntarily speak to patients. They are willing to share their numbers to the patients. And usually what happens is that the first 1 month is very important. So if we can support them through that 1 month, then definitely be able to take it. So in that time, the support groups are very important. We had a support group meeting just last week. In the support group, we had a film star who came and who spoke about their experience. So it all gives some courage to the patient, because nowadays people are willing to... Previously, people used to hide that they had cancer, and now openly telling that is a good thing, because whatever news they hear about cancer is a negative impact, because the stories which come out are the stories of people who died of cancer. But while the majority who are cured of cancer don't often, never used to speak. That is one thing changing nowadays. So so that is slowly giving a positive color to the whole cancer story nowadays.
We have one more question. Role of Fulstrat drug.
Yeah, there are some specific drugs which are, I think, they're all, I think, specifically, we can't randomly tell. So they're all hormonal manipulations, which may be helpful to prevent the cancer from spreading. And for, we may give these drugs for cancer just spread to other parts of the body. And if they're elderly patients who are not fit for chemo, we may just give them for fulvestrant, tamoxifen. Like, these are all hormonal blocking agents with which people have good quality of life, maybe many years. They may go on with this hormone manipulation. So it is a one of the major drugs which we use in cancer treatment. Okay.
I think we have answered most of the questions. Oh, yes. Yeah, one question which I had is, this clinical trials, are clinical trials available in India? Which should actually talk to the doctors about clinical trials?
Yeah, clinical trials, many hospitals have clinical trials. Previously, people used to be worried. They are like being tried. It's not that their drugs are being tried on them, because definitely that is how the cancer drugs come. Because sometimes patients may be resistant to all form of treatment. Then we give them specific drugs which may block newer pathways in cancer. So unless we try on patients, we don't know that. So the clinical trials should be given for people who have disease which has spread to many parts of the body, for whom there are no available treatment options. So that is how all these drugs, like fulvestrant, all, maybe there are 20 drugs which are being used in cancer, all have come to clinical trials. So they collect information, see, and all these drugs, there have some safety markers are there. So they are all closely monitored. And what I feel is that patients on a clinical trial get the best treatment, because then they are rigorously followed up for any toxicities. There is a dedicated team is there, a clinical trial unit is there, who take care of their whole things. So that I think like Tata Memorial Center, the regional cancer centers, all have a good clinical trial. We, and in corporate sectors also, we also have clinical trial units. And for it, and sometimes we refer patients trials to other big centers also. So we have to openly discuss with the patient and give them confidence that, and we have seen dramatic response, like immunotherapy, which you told, immunotherapy has shown to have dramatic response. And nowadays it is coming up in triple negative breast cancers and all. And definitely newer trials are definitely awaited in for this newer treatment modalities.
One more question was, what is the preventive aspect of breast? We have spoken a little, but preventive aspect of breast cancer in health and wellness centers that are coming up in India.
Yeah, health and wellness is a very broad topic. So nowadays, I think the big business is there about the cancer prevention. And again, cancer is such a rare disease. It's not that everyone gets cancer. It is such a rare disease. The yearly or the chance of getting cancer is still low only. So so that's why we should actively pursue this health and wellness. It's still a debate thing. What I tell people is that don't go for like active things, because I've seen people taking medicines worth 10,000 rupees a month to prevent cancer. Perfectly normal people taking drugs to prevent cancer. So whether you should go for that is an individual choice. And there have been a lot of trials which have tried using high-dose carotene and all in BEST, which have all shown that there is not much benefit in the people who took it and people who did not take that. Mm-hmm. So that is where the science is. According to science, there is no wonder drugs which can prevent cancer. So it is your call. And if you are able to maintain a healthy lifestyle, well and good. Whether you want to take these newer things, it is your call. That's all that we can tell from a doctor's perspective.
What is triple negative breast cancer difficult to treat?
Yeah, triple negative is a difficult thing, because what it means is that these hormone receptors or ER, PR, HER2 are not there in cancer cell. So again, in Indian, it is actually little more, around 30% triple negative breast cancers, which are more aggressive cancers. So the chance of recurrence is also on the high side. So that is why it is difficult to treat. But again, the people who are cured are cured for a longer period also. So I think it is not that term, like it is not difficult to treat, their chance of recurrence is more. we can treat them, we can give them chemotherapy for them, and there are many who are cured with cancer. So it doesn't mean that it's a negative thing. It only means that the receptors are absent on them. So again, this negative word gives a bad connotation to that. It is not that it's negative, outcomes are negative. The receptors are absent, so we have to be more aggressive with chemotherapy for them, and we should they should also have a more rigorous follow. Okay, that is what it means. And nowadays, this is again coming up in triple negative, and if the BRCA mutations are there, then triple negatives, we had put is one group where you check for BRCA mutation, and there one good thing is that mutations are there, we can give them drugs to block them. So newer things are coming up in triple negative breast cancers also.
One more question was, is there any role of BRCA1 in phosphorylation of the histone variant?
Oh, I think yeah. I think, yeah, it's a very complicated question. I think it's not for our every life anyway. Fine, okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think we have
almost an hour we have covered. Question. Yeah.
Yes.
Fine, good. Yeah. I think we have covered
any
most
more
of
questions?
I think we have spoken about the what are the causes of cancer, what are the preventive aspects, about the screening, and we also touched upon the biopsy part. And we also about the treatment aspects also we have touched upon, and I think about the follow. So being being a genetic counselor, that was a good thing that this doubt of BRCA also could be cleared to an extent for the patients. So I think it was a nice session. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Dr. Arun, for such a nice session. All the questions and queries were answered, and you put it in such a nice way that everyone I could relate on what has to be done exactly. And I guess this is a very good platform because every time they might not ask these questions promptly to the doctors, but you have answered all these questions. Thank you everyone for participating. Next week, next Saturday, again, we are having a session specifically for hereditary cancer. We'll all keep you updated about it. Thank you once again, Dr. Arun.
Thank you.
Thank you.